part of the Capriccio Italien, which Tchaikovsky began in Rome in the immediate aftermath of his father's death and finished on his return to Russia. As ever, Tchaikovsky's enthusiasm for Italy waned, and his thoughts turned almost obsessively to Russia. That old saying about the grass always being greener on the other side of the fence might have been coined specifically to describe Tchaikovsky.
I like travelling abroad for relaxation. It is the greatest of pleasures. But I could live only in Russia. Only by living somewhere else do you realise how much, despite all its faults, you love our dear country.
But once back in that dear country, he almost immediately began to dream of Italy, or Switzerland, or France, or, well, you name it.
It's a strange thing. When I'm in Russia, I dream from morning until evening, even at night, about going abroad as soon as possible. And in general, I seem to yearn to leave here. Yet nowhere am I at home. I am a nomad.
One of the appeals of travelling was that, depending on the place, he could be reasonably free of being accosted by acquaintances or admirers who would like to be acquaintances. One story he used to tell against himself, though he found it very amusing, concerned the time when he was walking down the street abroad somewhere, far from Russia, when a lady cried out delightedly in Russian, "Why, Pyotr Ilyich, what a wonderful surprise!" "I'm sorry, madam," he instantly replied, also in Russian, "but you are mistaken. I am not Tchaikovsky." And he continued on his way. Wherever he went, Tchaikovsky had a genius for spending money, and there's no doubt at all that Madame von Meck's financial support had in some ways corrupted him. He took too much for granted, and he knew it.
"From Madame von Meck I have received letters and an invitation to come to Brailovo, but not so much as a mention of any unusual payments. Meanwhile, I am filled with horror when I remember my debts and realize that until October I shall not have a kopeck. Oh, how spoiled I have become, and how remiss in appreciating all that I owe to that wonderful woman."
But it seems he could hardly help himself. Let him loose in, say, Paris, and thoughts of that wonderful woman were powerless against his spendthrift nature. In that way, he was no different from the man about town in his early Moscow days.
"Oh, how you'd laugh if you could see me here. I stroll the streets in a new grey overcoat and the most elegant of top hats, flaunting a silk plastron with a coral pin at my neck and lilac gloves on my hands. Passing by the mirrored piers on the Rue de la Paix or the boulevards, I invariably stop to admire myself, and I eye the reflection of my elegant person in all the shop windows. In general, I've been overcome at present, as has happened before, by a mania of coquetry. I've had a new suit of clothes made, and I've ordered a dozen shirts. The money flies, and in a few days I won't have a single franc in my pocket."
In the meantime, Antonina tormented him by alternately accepting and refusing a divorce, and at one stage she made his life intolerable by moving into the flat above his own. She also began to show signs of a mental imbalance greater than her husband's, becoming increasingly paranoid. For long stretches she would leave him alone, and then suddenly break her welcome silence with letters out of the blue which drove him to the brink of another emotional collapse.
"I do not want to be, even nominally, the wife of a man who so basely slanders a woman who has done him no harm. Why did you not start with yourself and tell of your own terrible vice before judging me? After all this, you stress in your letters your kindness and generosity. But where are these qualities and how are they confirmed? Please do not trouble to answer me. Everything is finished between us. And therefore I ask you, dear sir, not to indulge in any lengthy correspondence, but to deal only with this matter. But once again I repeat that I shall sign no filthy and untrue papers."
By this time her letters were badly unsettling Tchaikovsky before they were even opened.
"There is in this person, even in her handwriting, some poison that has a devastating effect on me. At the mere sight of the address written in her hand, I at once begin to feel sick, not only morally, but physically as well."
She continued to erupt unpredictably into Tchaikovsky's life, and the idea of divorce was eventually abandoned on both sides. It was eventually discovered that she'd given birth to an illegitimate child, which gave Tchaikovsky all the grounds he needed to divorce her. But by this time, he was too weary to pursue the matter. Well, no, there was more to it than that. He was also desperately worried that his homosexuality might become public knowledge if the case ever came to court. As it happened, Antonina, after having a whole string of illegitimate children, whom she deposited in a foundling's home, spent the last 20 years of her life in a mental hospital. But a Tchaikovsky not in emotional turmoil, at least in prospect, would hardly have been Tchaikovsky at all. The next crisis to envelop him concerned the drafting into the Russian army of his long-standing personal servant, Alyosha Sofronov. And no one close to him could doubt that this was very much more for Tchaikovsky than just the loss, and the temporary loss at that, of a servant. It was an event that almost triggered another nervous breakdown, and it had a serious effect on Tchaikovsky's creative life. In fact, the crisis began even before it was certain that Alyosha would actually be drafted. The decision was to be made on the basis of a drawing of lots, and all those whose names were in the hat, so to speak, had been summoned to attend the procedure in Moscow. Even before Alyosha's departure, though, Tchaikovsky confided to Madame von Meck,
"I am living on tenterhooks. Alyosha leaves tomorrow or the day after, and parting with him will not be easy for me. It is difficult to lose, perhaps for a long time, someone to whom you are tied by 10 years living together. I feel sorry for myself, but mostly I pity him. He will have to go through a great deal of suffering before he becomes accustomed to his new situation. To suppress my sad feelings, I have been working intensely."
Which, at the moment, he was still able to do. But hardly had Alyosha departed from Moscow than Tchaikovsky found it hard to think of anything else.
"Oh, my dear, my beloved Alyosha, as if by design I have felt dreadfully unwell ever since you left. How much easier all this would be for me to bear if you were here with me. Know that whatever happens, whether or not you go into the army, you will always be mine, and I shall never forget you, not for one moment. If you are indeed fated to go into the army, then I shall count the days impatiently awaiting your return to me. I kiss you warmly and embrace you heartily and tenderly."
Alyosha drew the short straw, as it were, and Tchaikovsky almost crumpled. Some days later, he reported to Modest,
"Alyosha has been drafted. I am managing to live tolerably only because I am always drinking. If it weren't for continual dinners and suppers with drink, I think I should literally go mad."
And some might say he almost did. He sought out Alyosha in his barracks, where he was predictably miserable, arranged to be in Moscow as often as he could, expressly for the purpose of being with Alyosha as much as possible, demeaning himself in attempts to win favours for his little soldier, as he called him, weeping much, as he confessed to Modest and Madame von Meck, and becoming, apparently, quite impervious to the increasing adulation in which he was held by the public at large, and the musical establishment in particular. He continued sporadically to drink himself drunk in order to dull the pain of his separation from Alyosha, whether in Russia or in Europe. And time brought little comfort. Long after Alyosha's induction, Tchaikovsky wrote to him,
"Every evening when I have undressed, I sit at my desk and start to grieve and to pine, remembering that you are not beside me. Absurd to say, I even weep a little every time I see anything that reminds me of you. No one will ever replace you. I embrace you most heartily, my dear Alyosha."
And new misfortunes, or the threat of them, began to crowd in on him. The death of Nikolai Rubinstein at the age of 46 shook him deeply. It seems also to have shaken him, if only briefly, out of the creative lethargy that had overtaken him. Almost the only work he managed to produce that year was an immensely long piano trio which he intended as an instrumental requiem for Rubinstein.